when you're used to doing things a certain way, and your mind has been trained to think a certain way, then you get involved in things that are so different, you know? And like, for instance, that song right there. To some people, that probably doesn't even mean a whole lot. It's like, what in the world are they even talking about? Refiner's fire. What does that have to, you know, what does that have to do with me? And, you know, when you start to really study the Bible, you start to realize that in ancient times, well, one of the things that has to do with precious metals is that there's a mixture of things in the metal. In other words, they call it an alloy. You know, sometimes in gold, there's things called dross. It's impurities that make the metal less pure. And the work of the refiner was that he would cause a fire to become heated, even more hot, if you will, because the hotter the fire, the hotter the metal, the precious metal, it would cause the impurities in it to come to the top where it could be dealt with. And then the refiner would be able to see the impurities and remove them, and it would make the metal more pure. And essentially, there's actually a proverb that talks about that whenever the dross or the impurities are removed from the metal, then a vessel can be produced that's proper for the use of the refiner himself, because he knows now what's in that thing. And that's really what the song's saying. It's saying to God as the refiner of our hearts. He's the one that can turn up the fire. He's the one that can cause the impurities that are in us to be brought up to the top. And he sees those things that are in our lives. And then whenever he sees them through the work of the Holy Spirit and the Word of God, he's able to remove them. It doesn't happen all at once. You don't get saved today and everything's gone tomorrow. But that there's a process as the fire is heated and these things are revealed to us and they're removed. And now we're separated. That's what the song was saying. And we use that church word a lot. I say church word, I'm starting to sound like the old church that used to pick on me. That Bible word, sanctification, which means to be separated out and to be made holy. You're not holy. I'm not holy. God is holy. Amen. But his work in our lives through the Holy Spirit and his word and what Jesus did at the cross, he makes us holy because of Jesus. Amen. He gives us the holiness of Jesus, and he also works in our lives through that, and he separates us out from the rest of the world, and he makes us a vessel that can be used by him. And why did I even say all that? Because I wanted to encourage you to know that sometimes, even though we choose songs even in this church for a purpose, because, and I didn't mean to get off on all this, but in the modern church, there's a lot of changes that are taking place. Yeah. Some of you may know that because you've been in church for a long time. Some of you may not be aware of that. I'm aware of it because I've done a lot of studying on the subject, because I had a big concern that there's changes that are taking place in the modern church. They're changing the music. It's not that some of the words never say anything at all good, but it's very vague. The music of the church always sang their theology. What does that mean? Sang what they believed. It lined up with the Word of God. It helped to teach the people what we believed in the Word of God. And so in this church, we're very meticulous about that. Some people may say, oh, well, they're not singing any new songs. No, we sing some new songs, but they're new songs that still preach the gospel. Amen. We're not going to sing songs just because they're new, because people think that they're cool. No, if they don't preach the gospel, we're not going to sing them. We're not going to. It has to tell the truth, because people are watering down the truth in the modern church. Amen. I mean, you can sing about the love of God all day long, but if you don't understand that that love presented itself in the form of Jesus hanging on a cross, and you're unwilling to let the world know that because you're scared it's going to offend them and make them feel funny on the inside, you're not willing to tell the truth. God's love was manifest in the fact that he sent his only begotten son to die on a cross, to hang naked there. Amen. Listen, sin, I mean, this is a whole other story. This doesn't have anything to do with my message. Sin left Adam and Eve exposed. We talked about that last week. Right. Left them naked and exposed. Jesus hung naked and exposed on a cross. Right. He bore your sin. He bore my sin upon him. That is the love of God manifest in the physical realm for you and I to see, that he loved us so much that he sent his only begotten son, the one who never failed, the one who was only always obedient. And he allowed him to be offered up as a sacrifice in your place and in my place, so that his wrath could be removed, and so that you and I could be restored into his presence. That's a beautiful thing. Because in the restoration of his presence, there's peace, there's joy, there's love. Yeah. There's sanctification. There's holiness. There's purifying of the heart. Amen. Praise God. There's things that God can do in His presence. Listen, a man can get up here and he can espouse a bunch of words and he can sound good doing it. But the reality of it is this, is that one moment in the presence of God, one moment with the Spirit of God moving and operating in our hearts can transform a life. Amen. Praise God. This morning I titled my message, Get Your Mind Right. Amen. Philippians 4 verses 6 through 13 says, Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things, those things which you have both learned and received and heard and seen in me do. And the God of peace shall be with you. But I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at the last your care of me has flourished again. Wherein you were also careful, but you lacked opportunity. Not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. I know both how to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. You know, the book of Philippians is one of these letters, really, we call the writings in the New Testament. You have the Gospels, which are Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, which tell the narrative stories, or the story, if you will, of Jesus, his ministry, his miracles, and also the crucifixion and his resurrection. That's you've heard of genres in music. You got, in worldly music, you got hip-hop, you got country, you got rock. Well, there's genres of literature also. And in the Bible, there's multiple genres, if that makes sense. And some of it's narrative. That's what the Gospels are. They're narrative. They tell a story. What we're reading this morning out of Philippians is what you call an epistle. It's a letter. Letters that were written by the apostles. Peter wrote letters. John wrote letters. 1st, 2nd, 3rd John. The book of Revelation was a letter to churches. And these letters that Paul wrote, he wrote 13 of them if you give him credit for Hebrews, which a lot of scholars do, and I personally think he wrote Hebrews. But these letters were written to the churches, and what we find in these letters is that Paul especially expounds on Christian, and I use the word again, theology. What is the word theology? No, it's not too big of a word. Theo means God, ology means study. It's the study of God. The letters of what the apostles wrote give us greater insight into the ministry that Jesus provided for us. And I've explained that on multiple occasions, but this is probably my favorite example, so I'll go ahead and use it real quick. Because I'm going to actually talk about it a little bit this morning. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 12, he had cast a devil out of somebody, and the Pharisees said, he cast out devils by the prince of devils, Beelzebub, which means Lord of the flies, the Lord of the demons, if you will. And Jesus told them, he said, if I cast out devils by the hand of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. Meaning, You're accusing me of operating under another spirit, but I'm here to tell you that if I am using the Spirit of God, then now you have literally seen the kingdom of God upon this earth in action, is what he was saying. And the demons listened to what Jesus said. He had authority over them. And then he explains, he uses this parable. He says that if a man was going to go into another man's house and take his spoil, he first had to bind the strong man. An analogy would be if somebody was going to go into a man's house to take his goods, he knows that the strong man or the owner of the house is awake and alert and possibly strong enough to stop the situation. So before he takes that chance, he's going to make sure he's got him bound. So you can imagine the owner of a house sitting in a chair bound up. And now you got free reign, because if you don't bind him up, you're going to have problems. What Jesus was saying was is that he came to earth because of its fallen state that had taken place because of the fall of Adam and how it had affected humanity. And he came to bind the strong man upon this earth. What Jesus did at the cross, now we don't necessarily understand exactly what he was saying because he didn't go into great detail. But what he did say, essentially what he was saying is he came to bind the strong man, which is Satan, on earth, so that the spoil of this earth could be taken. And the spoil of this earth regarding kingdom business is the souls of men. Now what Paul does is he comes back and he explains how that works in the real world, or spiritually, in the spiritual world, if you will, that Jesus, paying the penalty for our sin as he died on the cross, allowed us, and I'm going to explain it a little bit better for you here in a second, to become one with him in his death and his burial and in his resurrection from the dead. In other words, the old man born of Adam, who was born in sin, who was plagued by sin, who had the power of sin ruling and operating in his life and driving him towards sinful actions, that old man born of Adam, when he was born again, died, and a new man was born again spiritually and now has access to the grace of God and the strength of God. And in that sense, when we're that new creation, the strong man is bound in our life. And victory is given to us, amen, in order to walk according to God's will. That was just an example of how Paul expounds on the things that we learned that Jesus said that we might not understand completely, but when we put the two together, we gain a greater understanding of that. So essentially, that's the kind of genre that we're dealing with in this letter to the church of Philippi, that Paul is writing and explaining, and he's encouraging Christians that even though you're going through some things and he was going through some things, you need to understand that God is with you in the midst of all of that. Amen. As a matter of fact, the Apostle Paul's writing from prison right now. When he writes this letter, he's sitting in a Roman prison and he's writing this letter to the church in Philippi, which was a city in Asia Minor. And what's interesting is that six times in this letter, he uses the word joy. And I don't know about you, but if I'm sitting in a prison cell, I'm probably not necessarily real joyful. Although, I have a couple of people that come to church here that can tell you, and they would probably be willing to stand up right now and testify that they themselves had been in jail. And guess what? The Holy Ghost showed up, and they had more joy in there than they did when they were on the outside before. Hallelujah. As a matter of fact, one of my partners, he's over there teaching the kids right now. I hope you're okay with that. One of my partners that was in jail, and the Holy Spirit began to deal with his heart, and he gave his life to Christ. He said, I had more joy in me and I was more free in me. They wanted me. They were willing to move me to a better facility. He's like, I'm not going anywhere right now. I'm in the safest place you can be. I'm in the most peaceful place you can be. Because right here where I am right now, I'm right dead center in God's will. And he said, I don't want to go anywhere. Amen. And so we see the Apostle Paul, even though he's in prison, even though he's been through some things, the joy of the Lord is abounding in his life. Now, thank God that we're not in prison this morning. Amen. But that doesn't mean that we're not still going through some things. That doesn't mean that we don't still need the joy of the Lord on the inside of our hearts. Amen. So this morning, once again, the title of the message is that we need to get our minds right. Just a couple of things that I wanted to explain real quick. You know, he talked about the fact of being careful for nothing in that passage that we read. And that word careful really describes anxiousness and fearfulness. He also talked about the fact that he said that if we would make our requests known to God, if we would trust in the Lord, he would give us peace that surpasses understanding, and that he would keep our hearts and our minds. Now, one of the things that I wanted you to understand is that those words, heart and mind, when they're put together, they're describing the soul. They're describing part of your inner man, specifically who you are. The soul of man, when it says your heart, is talking specifically about your feelings, and the mind is talking about your thoughts. The reality of it is those two together make up who you are, your soul, your individuality. Many times we're ruled and reigned by our emotions and our thoughts. What Paul is wanting to instruct us is to let us know that when you're in the midst of a situation, you shouldn't be ruled by fear and anxiousness. You need to learn how to trust in the Lord, essentially. And when you do that, he's going to guard your emotions, and he's also going to guard your heart. Now, Real quick, I wanted to talk to you about a couple of things that the Apostle Paul learned in his walk with the Lord that helped him whenever he was going through difficult times. If you would go to Romans chapter 6, verses 3 through 4, I wanted to share with you now, a lot of people that have been coming to church for a while, you're familiar with this, and you know, I'll probably draw it almost every week, really, when I teach, because I don't think, this is a bold statement that I'm about to make, but I believe it with all my heart. I don't think that you can live a victorious Christian life unless you understand what I'm about to explain to you out of Romans chapter 6. Now, I'll tell you, you can understand it intellectually and still not live a victorious Christian life. Amen. Because you need more than just a cognitive or intellectual understanding. You need a spiritual revelation of it. Amen? Yeah. But until you're taught it, in a way that your mind can understand it, you'll never be able to receive a revelation of it. And I sat under a lot of different preachers, and they were well-meaning, and I'm not picking on them this morning. But you know, a lot of times you can only rise, because I used to explain this to people, like when I was in leadership in another church, say, man, you know, the preachers, pastors need to really focus on teaching God's people really what His Word says. Not just a whole bunch of stuff that they think people want to hear. No. You know what the Lord showed me was, you preach my word the way I wrote it. It's not your word, son. Amen. I don't want man. This is what I felt like the Lord told me. He may not speak to you this way. I don't want to give him credit for something that he didn't do, but I really feel like this is what I felt like the Lord told me. I don't want man putting his grubby little fingers and manipulating my word. Amen. God doesn't want man's dirty fingers in his word, changing it and twisting it for their own purposes. Present my word. This is what he told me. I was in a bar room. I'm not going to tell you the whole story. I've been living for Jesus for 12 years, and I found myself bound up. And in the midst of all of that, God showed up in a urine-stenched bathroom and said, present my word for the way that it is written, and then I will use you. One of the first revelations that he gave me had to do with Romans chapter 6. It was a key that unlocked a problem that I had in my understanding about God, that from that point moving forward was a foundation that propelled me into understanding God's word in a way like never before. So you're going to probably see me do this a lot. And I don't apologize for it, because I hope that with time, you'll really start to gain an understanding of it. Point number one of the things that God showed Paul for when he was in difficult times has to do with newness of life. In Romans chapter 6, verses 3 through 4, it says, know you not. In other words, he's asking you, really that word there, know, is agnaeo, and it can mean ignorant. Were you ignorant or were you disinclined? Now, I don't know about you, but the word ignorant, I used to get offended when people would call me ignorant. But, you know, if they know what they're saying, it's not really a bad word. It just means you didn't know. Does that make sense? So Paul's saying, didn't you know this? Hasn't anybody taken the time to teach you this before? That he said, and this is what he's asking, that as many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ, that we were baptized into his death. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death. That like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. Now, the thing that I oftentimes do is I draw on the board this picture of Adam, and I draw him all crooked, and I put these eyes like this, because truth be told, Adam, us born in Adam, there's an association, you understand that, of your first birth, that you were born physically in Adam. Does that make sense? The whole human race is considered Adam's fallen race. He is the father and the fountainhead of all humanity. Does that make sense? Every single human being that's ever walked on the face of the earth was born of Adam. Except one. Jesus. And the only one that wasn't born of Adam was Jesus. He comes from incorruptible seed, born of the virgin, who was without sin. Every other human being upon the face of the earth has walked in sin, has been born with sin, has a sinful nature in them, and therefore that's their nature, and so they're driven towards acts of sin. And so here we were, born of Adam, but what this is saying is, in this passage of Scripture, that you and I, when we believed, were baptized into Jesus through faith. In other words, you may not have known this, but on the day that you put your faith in Jesus, You heard the gospel. Somebody told you the good news about Jesus. Somebody told you that he died for you, that he bled for you, that he did that for your sin. And you, at some point, had to say, you know what? I mean, I don't understand it all, but I know I'm a mess. And I believe he did something for me. I'll put my faith in you, Jesus. And when you did that, I'm telling you, if you experienced the change, this is what happened. In the mind of God, you were baptized or placed in Christ. But you say, oh, but preacher, I hadn't been dunked in water. That's not what I'm talking about. Water baptism is an outward symbol of what's already happened spiritually through faith in what you did. When you put your faith in Jesus, okay? Yeah, I used to do this all the time, and it used to make people feel funny, but it's okay. I don't mind if you feel funny. Whenever you were born of Adam, you were born broken and dead. You were all over here broken and crooked, and you couldn't go the right way, and your foot was lame, and you kept going off the path. But then somebody told you the good news about Jesus, and you said, yes, I need Jesus. When you did that, the Holy Spirit, you couldn't see him. You might have felt something. You might not have felt something. But if it happened, you know what I'm talking about, because you're not the same as you were before it happened. The Holy Spirit took you and he baptized you. It means he put you in Christ. Spiritually, he changed your position. So he put you over here in Christ, a new environment, and in the mind of the Father, the old man that was born of Adam died with Jesus. You died with Jesus. And you were buried with him. And just as he was raised from the dead, you too should walk and newness of life. You became one with him in his death and his burial and his resurrection. Amen. To newness of life. Hallelujah. That's the first thing Paul understood was that the old man died, he was buried, and a new man has been resurrected to newness of life. There's been a change. There's been a new life that's taken place. Amen. And in this new life, the next thing is Romans chapter 5, verse 2. The next thing is that faith, the second thing that Paul understood about his new walk, Romans chapter 5, verses 1 and 2, I'm sorry. Faith brings access to grace. Faith changed your position. What are you talking about, preacher? Okay, let me explain it to you. The first time you were born in Adam, not only were you born in sin, but you were born in the world. Did that make you feel funny? You were born in the world, and now in your new life in Christ, you've been born again in Jesus. New position, new place. And in this place, guess what? You have access to grace. Over here, you had access to the world. Not saying that you're still not around the world. Not saying that sin's not still prevalent in the atmosphere. That's not what I'm saying. It's always going to be here. But what you didn't have before was now you're in a new place. And in this new place, there's grace. Amen? Amen. That's the main thing I want you to see here. What Paul said in Romans chapter 5, verses 1 and 2 is that therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. The word justified right there literally means that God declares you innocent. Oh, but you don't know what I've done, man. You don't know the things I've done. You don't understand the word of God. God says, if you would believe in what he has offered, his son dying in your place, if you would believe that by faith, this transaction would take place, and he would say, justified. He would say, no longer guilty. You're no longer guilty, and because of that, you have access to grace. Amen? Now, number three that Paul learned is out of 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. Number one, there's newness of life. Number two, in this newness of life, you have access to grace. Number three, God's grace is sufficient. Amen? It says in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9, he said unto me, now what Paul was, the story behind this is that Paul was dealing with something in his life. Nobody knows exactly what it is. Scholars have argued over what it could be. Paul called it a thorn in his side. A thorn in your side is something that just won't go away. It's sticking there, and it's very irritating, and you want it to leave, but it won't leave. The reason I believe the Holy Spirit doesn't let us know exactly what it is because he doesn't really want us to know what it is, because then we'll just focus on that. We won't apply it to our own lives. Basically, the thorn in Paul's side is whatever it is that keeps sticking you in your side. Do you understand what I'm saying? Whatever it is that keeps sticking you in your side, it won't leave. I need it to go. I cried out to the Lord. That's what Paul said. 3 times I asked God, would you please remove this thing from me? And this is what the Lord said. My grace is sufficient for you. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. Essentially, what the Word of God is saying right there is that there's times that we have a thorn in our side. Something keeps sticking us. Something keeps frustrating us. Something keeps making us feel like we're not getting where it is that we need to go. And what God's wanting you to know is this. Hold on. Put your eyes on me. Trust in me. My grace is sufficient for you. And let me let you in on this other little secret. My strength is made perfect in your weakness.
Amen.
When you can't get it done and you realize it and you start surrendering to me, that's when my strength, that's when my power takes over, because I need you to surrender your life to me. God allows thorns to stick you in your side sometimes. Can I get an amen? Amen? Sometimes God will allow thorns and painful circumstances to stick you in your side, to grab a hold of your attention and to let you know that you're not going to be able to get this one done on your own. And I've been working a whole long time, and listen, we're going to talk about this a little bit more, on you to get you to a place where you will surrender to me so that I can begin to move in your life and show you that I am God. Amen? Praise God. These are 3 things that Paul learned from God and wrote us in the scripture so that we would understand whenever we're about to go through things on the Christian journey. So armed with what Paul learned about the new life in Christ and access to grace, we can approach this passage of scripture that we spoke about in Philippians and learn how to face difficult times while we're on the Christian journey. Amen. Amen. Look at this. Philippians 4. We're going back to Philippians 4. And we're going to read verses 6 through 7. It says, be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts, your feelings, and your emotions, and your minds, your thoughts, through Christ Jesus. Point number one, don't be anxious or fearful. That's what the word be careful for nothing literally means. It means don't be anxious or fearful. God doesn't want you and I, when we're experiencing circumstances and going through trials and tribulations in our life, to be fearful or anxious. Now, that's easy to say. You tell me not to be anxious. You tell me to think on good things, but I have bad things going on in my life, preacher. My finances are a wreck. Things at the job are going bad and the marriage is falling apart, and you want me to not be anxious and you want me to not be fearful. Now, the good news is that the apostle gives these saints the cure for worry. It's called believing prayer. The word prayer, translated in this Greek word, literally means to address God as an act of worship with devotion and adoration. So really, when we're praying this away, what Paul is saying is that we're approaching him, the first part of it, with adoration. It's an act of worship. So what are you trying to tell me? Well, maybe you've never learned to pray this way. And I have to be honest with you, if I'm going to be real, I've seen Christians before that knew how to pray a whole lot better than I did. They read books on prayer. They learned the art of prayer. There's been Christians through the time frame of history that used to really seek God and pray. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you can read stories about people that believed in prayer. Men that wrote volumes about prayer. E.M. Bounds and other people that preached the gospel in the day, that had a prayer life that connected to God in a way like many of us probably don't know a whole lot about. But I can tell you that God had to teach me about prayer. And it was when I went through some very painful circumstances in my life, I really just didn't know what to do. I just brought myself to God in a broken state and basically kind of crumbled on the ground. I hate to admit to you that I had gotten that weak, but basically that's what had happened. And I fell to my knees. And when I fell to my knees and cried out to God in that state of brokenness, all of a sudden I felt a presence of God like I'd never felt before. From that time moving forward, when I find myself going through various trial and tribulation, the first thing I would do is I would approach God from a point of worship. It was more like, Lord, I just want to let you know that I'm so grateful for all that you've done. I want to thank you for the love that you've showed me in the way that you gave your son for me. I was going to him to worship and to adore him for all of his goodness, and I was being thankful for what he had done. At the same time, what it also goes on to say is this, is that it says, so the word prayer right there talks about worshiping the Lord, but the word supplication speaks of bringing one's personal needs before the Lord. So whenever you're going into prayer, you know, many times when we first get saved, we don't really understand how good God is. I mean, don't get me wrong, we've seen God move in our life, but we haven't gotten a deep revelation of how good he is. And so sometimes it's hard for us to go to him in that way and just to try to lavish him with love. And many times we just got some things going on in our lives and we're like, Lord, this is what's going on and I need you to fix this situation, right? But you know, God wants to hear what we're going through, but at the same time, the right heart from the right place is going to God because he's worthy to be adored. He's worthy to be worshipped. He's provided such a beautiful plan so that you and I could have a relationship with us. And so now that we've worshipped him, he wants to hear our needs. Just like a father that loves his child who's going through something wants you to be able to go to him, God the Father wants to hear Amen. What it is that you're going through. Next word is request. There's a translation that emphasizes the objects asked for. God wants you to be specific. He wants you to tell him what it is that you need in the midst of your situation. Now, unfortunately, when you find yourself in difficult times, you may think that you know exactly what it is that you need. I've learned in the process of time, and I've actually prayed this way. I don't know if it's the best prayer, and if some of you are better prayers than I am, you can correct me if I'm wrong. There's been times that I've been going through some stuff in my life, and I'm just like, Lord, I don't know what's best for me. No. I don't know what's best for me, and I'm asking you to do me a favor, Lord. Yeah. Grab me by the shirt collar and pull me through this thing called life, because at the end of the race, I want to see you, and I want to hear those words, well done, my good and faithful servant, but sometimes I don't know how to get there, and I think that I know what I need, and the reality of it is that I don't really know what I need, but at the same time, God wants you to bring your requests and your specifics to him, and so, you know, the thing of it is that I need you to fix it, but one thing I need you to know is this, sometimes God doesn't want to fix it. Sometimes God wants to fix you.
That's right.
Sometimes God wants to fix me. Amen. And when you find yourself in difficult times, you got to remember that God is worthy to be worshipped and adored. You must go to him, worship him, and you must also tell him about your need. But you also need to understand that God is ultimately the orchestrator of circumstances, and he knows what's best for you. Amen.
Amen.
And you got to keep on holding on
Amen.
And trusting, even if he doesn't fix the situation exactly the way that you wanted him to fix it. Does that make sense? Amen? I think it does. But also in that passage, he used the word unto. He said that let thanksgiving and your request be made known unto God. I thought this was interesting in my studies. The word the preposition right there, unto, in the Greek text, suggests the translation in the presence of God. So you're making your request known unto God. There's a recognition here that I am literally in the presence of God. When I understand this, the old man that was born of Adam, put faith in Christ, became one with him in his death, burial, and resurrection, and now he has access to grace. And when he goes into the presence of the Lord and he brings an adoration to God and he begins to bring his request known unto God, he needs to know this, unto, I'm in the presence of God. And that in the presence of God, in that atmosphere, is no place for fear and anxiety to rule and reign. Because in the presence of God, hallelujah, there is peace yes. and that there is joy. Yes. because his presence dispels all darkness. You and I need to begin to understand that, that in the presence of God, amen, there's joy and there's peace and there's strength. What we learn from this in the apostle is that as believers, there's a new way to handle our lives, a new way to handle the situations that we encounter. Instead of becoming anxious and fearful about circumstances that we can't change, we learn to trust God when we are driven by fear and anxiety. We are driven to try to fix it ourselves in our own strength and wisdom. You know what I'm talking about? I don't know about you, but I remember clearly. Whenever I used to find myself in the midst of frustrating situations and things going on in my life, I tried to fix it my way. Sometimes people do things that frustrate me and aggravate me. Back in the day when I didn't have anything that I really had to worry about, I might try to fix it by force. I can't go trying to fix stuff by force now. I mean, goodness gracious, nursing board, rip my license away from me. I'm going to be trying to beat people up or trying to do stuff like that. And even really, sometimes I got to be careful because sometimes people say things to me even in the clinic. And it's like, I want to. If I try to fix it the whole way, I just go off and start telling people what I think about. I can't do all that. I can't fix that. Or even worse, back in the day, whenever things didn't go my way, I was just like a little horse. You ever seen a horse that you talk about, they put a carrot in front of that horse to try to make him go in a certain direction? That's what the enemy used to do to me. When things would go bad, he put a carrot over here and he tried to get me to go over that way. However it was, whatever I would do in order to numb the pain, in order to fix the situation, or not fix it, but just numb it, forget about it for a period of time until it comes back. And you know, these are repetitive behaviors that we've learned in the world. Repetitive behaviors that we've learned in the world on how we cope with and try to deal with our own situations. But in the new life in Christ, there's a whole new life and a new way of handling your business that has to be learned. Amen? And so what Paul is explaining to us is that the new man has access to grace. He learns that he can bring his problems to God. He can pray as an act of worship. He can make a specific request known to God. God wants to hear what we need, and we can be assured that we are in his presence and we have access to his grace. His grace is sufficient, and where there is grace, there is peace.
Amen.
I like that one part of that verse. It says right there, "And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus." The peace of God that passes all understanding. I use this scripture a lot because I just love what it means. It means that it doesn't make any sense. Really, logically, in a worldly sense, it doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make sense that the couple of people I was telling you about could have been in jail. And yet, even though they were locked up behind bars, they had more peace while they were in there than they did while they were on the outside. It doesn't make any sense to the logical mind, but it makes a whole lot of sense spiritually. Because when they were in the world, they didn't have God with them. And now even though they're in there, the presence of God is with them. The grace of God. So what I need you to know is this. Your circumstances might not have changed. Your situation might not have changed. But when God's presence shows up, when we start learning how to trust God, and not in anxiety and fearfulness, but bringing it to him, then his peace shows up and it doesn't even make any sense. Praise God. And then through that, he keeps. The word keep there means to keep a watchful guard. It describes like an army garrison, like a big infantry of the army surrounding and protecting what? Your mind, your heart, your emotions, and your mind. If you will trust in God, bring your request to him. Let yourself realize, I can't fix this situation. God, I give it to you. God promises to turn around, amen, and to protect your emotions and your mind, the thoughts that are on the inside. I was thinking of this illustration of Daniel. You remember the story of Daniel out of chapter 6, verses 10, 11, and 18, and 22. You don't have to necessarily turn there. I'll just tell you the story real quick. Daniel, as a young boy, had been caught up in what they call the Babylonian captivity. Israel had been disobedient to God, and Israel's enemy came and took the best that was in Jerusalem and brought them back with them to Babylon. I did I preached on this one time at Isabella and them school, and I remember Googling, how far is it from Jerusalem to Babylon, where Daniel and them were. And it was essentially like it would be if you went from Houma to San Antonio, from what I remember. Now, but you got to understand, they walked. They didn't drive. It took me 8 hours to drive there the other, a while back. They walked it. Now, so now they're in a completely different culture. Not only that, he's in prison at first. Okay, but at some point in time, Daniel refuses to go the way of the world, and he takes a stand for God. And because of that, he's elevated. In this portion of the story that I'm telling you about, Daniel trusted God. God elevated him, and now Daniel has been placed over all of the leaders of the provinces in this area. But they do a sneak attack on him because they're envious of him, the ones that are right under him, and they get the king to sign a letter or an edict or a law into place that says if any man for the next, I can't remember, I'm shooting from the hip, 30 days, something like that, prays to any god other than through to you, then he needs to be, the penalty is death. Well, Daniel hears this. And what he decides to do is this. Same thing he always did. Right. He goes to the Lord in prayer. He knows one thing. The God that I serve is a God that's worthy to be adored. He's a God that's worthy to be worshipped. And I'm not changing anything. The circumstances might have changed. The environment around me might have changed. But God hasn't changed. He's called me to pray. He's called me to trust him. I'm going to do the same thing. Went over there like he always did before. And this time, I don't know if he did it before, but he opened up the window and he sat there. And as the window was open, he went to the Lord in prayer. And they heard what he did. They saw what he did as he went to the Lord in prayer. And because of that, they threw him in the lion's den. You remember the story? Well, guess what? The most amazing thing happened. Daniel had just a peaceful night of sleep. Those lions didn't eat him. And he rested peacefully in the midst of that lion's den. And the next morning, the Bible says that king tossed and turned all night long. He tossed and turned all night long. He didn't have any peace because he didn't want Daniel to die because he felt bad about the whole situation. But Daniel had peace in the midst of that situation. A peace that surpasses all understanding. It doesn't make any sense that you could be arrested in the province that you live in, thrown in a lion's den, yet you would have peace where the very king that put you there can't sleep in his bed that night. It's the same thing we talked about last week with Pilate. His wife had no peace, yet Jesus is about to go to the cross and he's in perfect peace because he knows that he's in the will of God. Amen. That's something that you and I can't manufacture. That's something that you and I can't create. That's something that only God, the Holy Spirit, can provide and give to us, the peace of God. Amen. Through the presence of the Holy Spirit. You trust in the Lord. Quit taking matters into your own hands. Bring your concerns to him, and his peace is going to keep your heart and mind. Amen? Yes. That brings me to point number two. Keep your mind on the things of God. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things. Essentially, the apostle is teaching us that there are things that are holy and virtuous and true. Things that are of the Lord and not of the world. These are the things that we're supposed to set our mind on. He promises that if we will trust in him and pray to him and make our requests known to him, that his presence will be right there to hear us, and that his grace will bring us peace, and that he will protect our souls and our minds. But you need to understand something. We can't turn around and go right back to putting our heart and our mind on the things that we always had our heart and mind on previously that caused all the confusion in our lives. And many times that's the struggle that Christians have. We used to put our heart and mind on things that were in the world, and now even though we're new people in Christ, we revert back to the old way of doing things, the old way of trusting in the wrong things. And what the Lord is saying is that, what Paul is saying is, no, you got to keep your mind on the things of God. You got to put your heart on the things of God. Now, I got to tell you something. That's not always the easiest thing to do. That's why it's so important for us to understand the concept of the renewal of the mind. Amen? Can you go to Ephesians chapter 4, verses 20 through 24? We're talking about thinking upon and keeping your mind on the things of God. It says in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 20 through 24, "But you have not so learned Christ." He was talking in this letter to the Ephesians about the way that the world acts and behaves. And then he transitions and he says, "But you haven't learned this isn't what you learned from Jesus, basically. In your new life, this isn't what the Lord taught you to act like this. If so be that you have heard him." In other words, this isn't what you learned. All these things I just listed, all this lying and sexual perversion and all this other stuff, that's not what you learned from Jesus. If you really have learned of him, if you really have been born again and you've been in this thing a while, you didn't learn all that stuff from Jesus. No. "And have been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus." And this is what you've been taught. "You should put off concerning the former conversation the old man." Now, I've explained this to you before. I like the King James Version, but I got to tell you that every now and then you run into a situation where there's a word that's outdated. And that word conversation right there is outdated. It doesn't mean like if you and I sit down after church and we have a conversation. That's not what it's talking about. It's talking about your way of living. Okay. Your conduct. How you order your life. You understand what I'm saying? You know what? After I got saved a while, I can remember calling up some of my old friends that I used to run with in Lafayette. And I'm calling them up, and this was something new that happened after I left. Some new phrase that they came up with. It's like, "Ain't no shame in my game, bro." Whatever that meant. It was like, I don't know, I'm dirty. Whatever it was supposed to mean. Well, that was your old conversation. That was your former conduct. That was the way you used to handle your business. If you're in Christ, you're going to need a little bit of shame in your game. You got to worry about how you're treating other people, how you're handling your business. Why I got to worry about how I handle my business, preacher? Because you're an ambassador of Jesus. If you're really born again, you're telling people that there's been a change in your life, and you can't keep on living the old way that you used to live. Well, I'll struggle with things. Okay, fine. Throttle down. Hold on a second. God will get you through. God will change you, but you have to understand that your old conversation, your former way of living, was connected to the old man, your first birth in Adam, that was broken and dead. Well, you've got a new life now. Your old man is not who you are now. It says, "You have not so learned Christ, if so be that you have heard him and have been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off your old way of living, the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness." Now, I got to tell you, if you understood the Greek language, and I don't really understand it that great, but I got some really cool books that I can read behind Greek scholars, and I can read some Greek and understand some things. But essentially what I need you to know is this. If you really understood what it was saying is, it's almost like taking off one shirt and putting on another one. The old man born of Adam, I'm not going to do it, but you take off your shirt, that was Adam, and you throw it off to the side, and you come over here and you take your new shirt, your new man in Christ. Born of Adam the first time, born again in Jesus the second time. I put him on. His righteousness. His holiness. Right? But the truth is that you got to be renewed in the spirit of your mind to even understand what this means. Yes. So when I first was saved and sat in the church, what the preacher, when he would talk about this, would say is, that's why you got to read your word every day. You got to read your word every day. And so he didn't break it down, and I'm not picking on him. I'm just saying, if you happen to watch the video, I'm not picking on you. What I'm trying to say is this. That caused me to turn my Bible reading into a rule. Yeah. In other words, okay, that's the problem. I got to read 3 chapters today. And then when I didn't read 3 chapters and only read 2, I felt guilty because I didn't meet my daily reading requirements. That's not what Paul's talking about. Paul's talking about, yes, it has to do with the Word. It has to do with the Word and the Holy Spirit working in union with one another, training our hearts and minds to understand the things of God, which means we're learning now of Jesus. I use this analogy all the time, and I just really can't think of a better analogy to use. So please, if you get tired of it, I don't mean to be redundant. I'm just trying to explain it the best way I know how. I use it with people in the world, too, that don't know anything. You were enculturated in your first birth of Adam, in your family. I bring it down to the lowest level I know how to bring it. You were born a baby into your household. And your people will learn things from their people. And I use myself as an example. You got to plug yourself in there and you know your story. Some of you were hunter and fishermen. You learned some of those things. Some of that's some good stuff, right? I mean, hey, you could probably live off. I can't live off the land. If I hang out with you for a little while, maybe I can learn. But right now, I'm going to be in a bind. I'm going to come begging you for some fish one day, okay? But the point that I'm trying to make is this. In my family, once again, my dad, I've said this before, he grew up in a house where there was a whole bunch of boys. They were real rough. They played football, and they liked to fight, and they drank. Their daddy drank. And he was mean and aggressive. And so what they did when they grew up is they drank and they got in barroom fights. And that was what they did on the weekend. My mama's family, they're a little bit more cultured. You know, they say that they're not Cajun, that they come from Paris, France, and whatever the case, and that we're royalty. Okay. Her claim to fame is that Delaney was one of the first governors that got his head cut off in the French Revolution. But anyway, that's another story for another time. My grandfather was the sheriff of Jefferson Davis Parish for 27 years. But he had only had like a 10th grade education. So, I mean, he had kind of climbed the ladder in the police force and he had done well for himself. He liked to drink Scotch whiskey, though. And so, basically, whenever you go to the house of Lake Arthur there, and Dad fit in real well with him because they stay up all night, they play Blu-ray, they drink Scotch whiskey, and everybody was real loud. Kids weren't allowed at the table, right? And we ate gumbo, and we did this, and this was our life. You just learned. I mean, you sat down there underneath the porch, and that's what Grandpa did. By the end of the day, he never got so sloppy like I used to get. He always could at least still talk, but you could tell he had a little bit too much by the end of the day, you know? And so that was kind of like the culture, I guess, that you could say that I grew up in. Then when you take it to the next level, I started having some friends. It depends on who you hang out with, right? And some of my friends were going in a certain direction. Then the music that we listened to. I'm just being honest. I keep remembering this one song, and I don't mean to be weird, but it was by Motley Crue. I give up my age. And he talked about, I take a swig of whiskey and I jump into the saddle with you. I don't know why that sticks in my head, because I guess that was like, man, that sounds like the kind of party I want to go to. And I'm sure there was a whole lot there. I'm not going to break down those words for you. Yeah. You figure that one out for yourself. The point being is that, hey, that's how my mind was. Yeah, let's do this. Yeah. This sounds like a real fun party. I was enculturated by the world around me and the things that I was in. You got to plug yourself into that situation. But what this scripture saying is that was your old man. Yeah. That was your old former life. Now you've been introduced into a new life in Jesus. And the way that you're going to learn about that new life and that new love, because it comes from another realm. God's word, God's love comes from another place. Amen. Jesus came from heaven to earth. The earth was fallen because of the fall of Adam and Eve. Because of the fact that we were born of Adam, that sinfulness and that old conversation or lifestyle has spread through the entirety of the human race. And now God desires to re-enculturate us, to teach us the ways of God, the things of God, and for our mind to understand God's ways. Does that make sense? That's a renewed mind. That's a renewed mind that's going to give us an understanding of the ways of God. And so we can't put our mind on the old things that we used to put our mind on. We need to put our mind on the things of God. Amen? So when we find ourselves in difficult times, circumstances, we can go to the Lord. We can pray. We can make our requests known to God. We can be assured that we're in the presence of God and that He promises, if we'll do that, to keep our hearts, our emotions, and our mind, our thoughts, to protect them. But at the same time, we can't turn right back around and go back to putting our mind on the things that we used to do. Does that make sense? Once again, what is it that you in your life have repetitively gone back to when things don't go the way that you expected them to go? What is it in the past that you have trusted in that wasn't the Lord? Because I have to tell you that that's the area that God wants you to stop going back to that and start going to Him. Does that make sense?
Amen.
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 Number three, He gives strength. Philippians chapter 4, verses 10 through 13. It says, "But I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at the last your care of me has flourished again. Wherein you were also careful, but you lacked opportunity. Not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. I know both how to be abased, which means to have nothing, and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things, I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. Now, I want you to see right here, first off, that in the beginning, in verse 10, where he says, I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at the last your care of me has flourished again. The idea of the word flourished again describes a tree that was basically dead and didn't have any fruit on it, all of a sudden to blossom. He says right here, he says, wherein you were also careful, but you lacked opportunity. The word careful there, you remember how in the beginning we said, he said, be careful for nothing. And we said it meant anxious and fearful. The same word right here. He says, you were careful, but you lacked opportunity. What this is talking about, Paul was in prison. The church in Philippi wanted to send him a love offering. He's saying, you were anxious about it because they wanted to get it to him. Does that make sense? They wanted to help him because they knew he was in a bind. He said, but you lacked opportunity. There was no way they could do it. So they're over there kind of stressing because they're like, Paul has really poured his life into us. He's in prison, not because he was selling drugs, but because he was preaching the gospel.
Amen.
And he's had a huge part in our lives. And we want to bless him. Thank God for that. Because, you know, truth be told, most times the preachers ended up in prison. Everybody probably forget about him, you know. Lord help us. Because I'm just saying, like, there was a pastor in Iran that was in prison. And, you know, I knew about it. And, I mean, I prayed for him about 2 or 3 times, but I should have been praying every day for that brother. Amen. But that's another story. But the point that I'm trying to make is this, is that he said, your care, you were concerned about me. Now you got the opportunity. And then he turns around, he says, not that I speak in respect of one. It's not, I'm thanking you, but I don't want you to think that I was over here stressed out over the situation, because he's saying, I've learned to be abased, and I've also learned to be abundant. In other words, the Lord, sometimes I go through seasons. One of the things that we have to understand about the Apostle Paul is that based upon the scriptures, it seems as though his life early on was very affluent. What I mean by that is he was a Roman citizen. We know that from the scriptures. He was a Pharisee, which means he was a leader in the religious hierarchy of Jerusalem. He studied under a man named Gamaliel, and Paul, his name was Saul before that, was from a place called Tarsus. That means for him to study under Gamaliel, to be able to become a Pharisee, he had to really study abroad. We don't know this for sure, but some people have speculated that he also made tents for a living, that possibly that was the trade that he learned from his father, because oftentimes that's the way it happened. Some people have speculated that maybe Paul's daddy received his Roman citizenship from making tents for Roman armies and, you know, whatever. We don't know that. But nevertheless, Paul was born a Roman citizen. Pharisees typically had money, some of them more than others. The point that I'm saying is this, is that the Apostle Paul in the first part of his life was powerful, and he was a man that had wealth, if you will. But now, after his conversion, things have changed. After his conversion, he's a prisoner in a Roman jail. See, this doesn't work real well for the word of faith preachers out there. The ones that are on TBN, I'm just being honest with you. You watch whatever you want to watch, but this don't fly with the word of faith. Because see, the Apostle Paul, he said it right here. I'm instructed. But who are you instructed? Well, Paul don't write nothing of instructed by man. Paul only writes being instructed of God. I've been instructed both to be full and to be hungry. Well, the word of faith preachers say you should never be hungry. You should never have lack. That God lacked for you so that you could be abundant. No, sometimes in the life of Christianity, there is lack. There is hunger. There is desolation. Sometimes people are persecuted for their walk with God. If people don't like to hear that, the reality of it is they don't like to hear the truth of the gospel. There may be a time before the Lord comes back where we suffer persecution, where we find ourselves in the midst of trial and tribulation. But even in the midst of all of that, what Paul says, I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. Once again, they were unable to do what they wanted to do, but Paul was grateful for their help. And you know, part of it is that he said, I have learned. And that was one of the main things that I was trying to bring up to you. He didn't understand probably what it meant to be poor before. You know, the other day I was preparing for a lecture that I had to spoke to some nursing students. And I was reading in this book, and it talked about part of what you have to think of as a nurse is people's family life and their situation. In other words, what I guess I'm trying to say is, I can be a healthcare provider and say, oh, you have to go to Children's Hospital, and I write an order and send somebody to Children's. I don't even know the first thing about this poor person. They might even have transportation. How in the world are they supposed to get there? And in the times past, you don't really think about that. But I was actually driving to work that morning. It was the strangest thing that happened. And I thought to myself, I have never had my electricity cut off. By the grace of God, I've never had my electricity cut off. I just don't know what that's like. We weren't rich, but we were at least upper middle class. Never had to worry about the electricity bill. At least not that I remember. The electricity bill was never went off. And that morning when I got to work, there was a woman who had just moved from Rain, Louisiana. And her, long story short, she had to get Medicaid transportation to bring her from Gibson to the office. Well, whenever the driver found out the office wasn't open, he dropped her off in Walmart parking lot. And that woman had to walk with her kid from Walmart parking lot to our office. Now, that driver got in trouble, and I don't know if she still has her job. But the point is that I can tell this lady she needs to go to Children's Hospital all I want, but I haven't even involved myself to know what it is that she's going through. The point I'm trying to make? Paul had to learn. Paul had to learn what it was like to go through things. Okay. Because before, he lived his life in such a way that he had power, he had wealth, he had the things that he needed. Sometimes, as Christians, we have to learn things. We have to learn that we have to go through things. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 28, show us some of the things that happened to the Apostle Paul that helped him learn. He says, are they Hebrews? He was talking about these religious leaders that were coming against his teaching. He says, well, so am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they the seed of Abraham? So am I. Are they ministers of Christ? He says, I speak as a fool. I am more. All these things that these people are telling you that they are, to be honest with you, I got the credentials. I got more credentials than they have. You want to talk about skins on the wall? I'll show y'all my diplomas. Boom, we can line the wall up with them. That's what the Apostle Paul said. I got the diplomas, the skins on the wall to show you these guys are talking the talk. I've walked the walk, is what he's saying. He says, I am more in labors, more abundant, in stripes above measure. What does that mean? I took more whoopings on my back for the gospel of Jesus Christ than these people have even thought of. As a matter of fact, probably ain't none of them ever been whipped, but I've been whipped. He says this, he goes on to say, above measure, in prison more frequent, in death, almost facing death more often. And then he goes on to explain it more in detail. Of the Jews, 5 times received I 40 stripes, save one. What does that mean? I got hit 5 different times. I was beat with a whip with 39 lashes. 40 times save one, that means 39. 40 minus 1 equals 39. Why? Because that was a Roman rule. If you were a Roman citizen, you could not be hit with a whip more than 39 times. People used to say, oh, well, Jesus took 39 stripes on the back. Jesus wasn't a Roman. Jesus was a Jew. We don't know how many times they hit Jesus with a whip. But Paul says 5 different times they whooped me. 39 lashes. Can you imagine that? 5 different times, 39 times hit on the back with a whip. Yes, sir.
Didn't they think that 40 stripes would kill a man? So
yeah, that's what the concept was. Yep. And so, and that was a part of being a Roman citizen. No matter what you had done, you couldn't take more than 39 stripes. But he says this. He goes on to say, 3 times, thrice. This what means 3. Was I beaten with rods? So not only was he beat 5 times with a whip, but 3 different times people hit him with sticks. Once I was stoned. You can read about that in the book of Acts. He's preaching the gospel. And the next thing you know, they turn around And he said something they don't like. They start stoning him, left him for dead. And the next morning he woke up and the grace of God touched him and he dusted himself off and he said, let's move on to the next town and preach. He says, I suffered shipwreck. A night and a day I've been in the deep, meaning floating around in the water, in journeyings often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen. In other words, people jumping me, beating me, robbing me, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painful, in painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings, in cold and nakedness. You've been on a journey, I mean, I don't know this for sure, on a journey, and robbers attacking him, ripping him of his clothes, leaving him naked, in the rain, in the cold, without food. He keeps on preaching the gospel. Keeps on preaching the gospel. He goes on to say, beside those things that are without, that which comes upon me daily, the care of all the churches. I just think about this. A man of affluence, a man of power, a man who was raised with money, a man who was on a fast track to be a powerful person. And he is converted radically by the presence of God, changing his life.
Amen.
And he gives his heart to this purpose of preaching the gospel. And no matter what happens, he continues on. He had to learn this. You and I, part of the process of our walk with God, are going to have to learn that we're going to go through things. And that when we do, there's a new way to approach it. Not the old way of going back to the old things, but a new way of trusting in God, bringing our concerns to Him, worshiping Him, adoring Him through prayer, making our requests made known. Had to be learned. It had to be learned that even though things were bad, he didn't have to be anxious and fearful, but he could trust God and pray. Had to be learned that when things were bad, instead of going back to the old way, he could think on the things of God. It had to be learned that when he was naked in the cold or beaten with a whip or in prison for the gospel, that God's presence was still with him. He wasn't alone, and he wants all Christians to know that we can learn this too. You're not alone, Christian. God's presence is with you, and you can do it. I can do what? You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. You know, I wasn't thinking about this, but every time I think of this scripture, I think of that fight with Mike Tyson and Evander Holyfield. You remember that fight? The reason I remember it is because Evander Holyfield, because nobody, you can't beat Mike Tyson, man. Nobody can beat Mike Tyson. You know, and all of a sudden, Evander Holyfield comes out with a robe on, a Philippians 4:13. Well, I bet you everybody was, well, I don't even know if we had cell phones back then, but, you know, we looked it up in our Bible. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That devil, I'm just telling you, Mike Tyson full of a devil in that fight. I'm not saying he's possessed now, I don't know, but he was full of the devil in that fight. Reached over there and bit that man's ear off. Bit a chunk of his ear out. Evander Holyfield still beat him in that fight. And, you know, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I thought this was interesting to learn this. The word strengtheneth means to be filled up. And the idea, the word in the Greek would be used to fatten like an animal. Yeah. It means to be satiated or to be made full or satisfied. So the word strengthened there describes being filled up and fattened like an animal. Have you ever seen a lion after he's eaten his prey? Mm-hmm. I mean, before he gets a hold of his prey and eats it, there's a lot of fear and anxiety going on, right? When am I going to get that next? But after that, his belly's all swollen. He's just laying there, man. He's in a daze, and you got to take him a nap. For that moment in time, he is satisfied. He is calm. He is completely at peace. He just lays there without any worries, takes a lazy nap. This word describes you being filled up by God and being satisfied. You can do all things through Christ. Whether you're hungry or you abound, whether you're in prison or you're in the nicest of houses on your couch, whether you are going through something or right now there's peace in the midst of your life, you can do all things. Why? Because Christ is strengthening you. He's filling you up. The idea is that he's putting the strength in you, amen? And he's satisfying you. So this morning's message was get your mind right. Don't be anxious or fearful. Keep your mind on the things of God. And remember, he's the one that gives us strength, amen?